At this time, it is my pleasure to introduce to you the esteemed dais that we have for tonight's event. I will begin with the top tier, to my right, your left. Willie Terrell Jr., Meritorious Service Award recipient, Dayton Unit, NAACP. The Honorable Jesse O. Gooding, 18th President and President Emeritus, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Reverend Renee Shepherd, Community Service Award recipient. The Honorable Roland Winburn, State Representative, 40th House District. Peggy Miller, wife of our President Award recipient. Paul A. Miller, Sr., Outstanding Neighbor, President Award recipient. The Honorable Fred Strayhorn, State Senator, 5th Senate District. Dan Foley, President, Montgomery County Commission. The Honorable Ryan McClinn, Mayor, City of Dayton. Richard Wall, Outstanding Leadership Award recipient. Vale K. Miller, Jr., CEO, Heidelberg Distributing Company and Banquet Honorary Chair. The Honorable Kevin L. Boyce, Treasurer, State of Ohio, and tonight's keynote speaker. Dr. Joseph E. Saliba, Provost, University of Dayton, representing Dr. Dan Curran, Banquet Honorary Chair. The Honorable Derek Forward, 21st President, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Jean A. Forward, Dayton Unit's First Lady and Advisor of the Little John Junior Youth Council. Michaela D. Sloan, President, Little John Junior Youth Council. Mr. Omar Williams, Chairman, Freedom Fund Committee of the Dayton Unit. Sonia E. Williams, spouse of Mr. Omar Williams. Ophelia Averett, President, Akron Unit, NAACP and National Board Member. The Honorable Sybil Edwards McNabb, President, Ohio Conference, NAACP. Reverend Ronald McNabb, Chaplain, Ohio Conference, NAACP. Jeffrey Mims, President, Dayton Board of Education. Lori Ward, Deputy Superintendent, Dayton Public Schools. Attorney Alvarine Owens, Owens and Associates. And Mr. Phil Plummer, who's coming? Ladies and gentlemen, that's our top tier. Please welcome them. Now our lower tier, to my right, your left. Gregory M. Gnant, Chairman, Montgomery County Republican Party. Mark E. Owens, Chairman, Montgomery County Democratic Party. Douglas Fecker, President and CEO, Wright Pat Credit Union. Anthony Whitmore, Director of Government and Community Relations, Greater Dayton RTA. Linda Hoffman, Community Affairs Manager, Vectren Energy Delivery of Ohio. Dr. David Hopkins, President, Wright State University. John Garland is supposed to be here, and he's coming, I promise. Then we have Dr. David Smith, CEO and Medical Director, Community Blood Center and Community Tissue Services. Larry Porter, Board Chair, Sinclair Community College. Joey Williams, President, Chase Bank. Natasha Williams, who is the wife of Joey Williams, but she kind of has a day job as a news anchor at WHIO Television. Dr. Sharon R. Johnson, Vice President and Satellite Schools Director, International Apostolic University of Grace and Truth. Dr. Gloria Forward, President, International Apostolic University of Grace and Truth. Reverend Herman Branham, First Vice President, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Diana Branham, Reverend Branham's spouse. Rosa E. Smith, Second Vice President, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Ryan Dunson, 3rd Vice President, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Minta D. Kimball, Secretary, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Janice E. Kimball, Treasurer, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Reverend Crystal D. Jackson, Assistant Secretary, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Lorenzo Harris, Assistant Treasurer, Dayton Unit, NAACP. Mr. Sheldon Mitchell, President and CEO, Dayton Urban League. Cassandra Shannon Mitchell, Mr. Mitchell's spouse. Linda J. Bold, Chair, ACTSO Youth Program. Carolyn Perkins, Advisor, Dayton Youth Council. And D'Angelo Bird, President, Dayton Youth Council. Please give a round of applause for all of our dais guests. At this time, we will have the presentation and posting of colors, Central State University Army ROTC Color Guard, followed by the national anthem by Miss Shanila Dunford, Shea Buddha Band, who will sing the Star Spangled Banner, and the Negro National Anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed as the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous night. Oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, bursting in air, gave proof to the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? Oh, the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Now, if you can please join me in singing the Negro National Anthem, please.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmony of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening
that the presence has brought us. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Facing the rising sun of our new day. March on till victory is won.
Ladies and gentlemen, please thank the Central State University Army ROTC Color Guard, and you may be seated. At this time, I would ask Reverend Crystal Jackson, Assistant Secretary, Dayton Unit, NAACP, to please come forward and give tonight's invocation.
Please let us bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you this evening. We thank you, Lord, for a 100-year celebration of the NAACP. We thank you, Lord, for the 58th year celebration of the Dayton Unit NAACP. Lord, we thank you for the bold dreams and the big victories, Lord, that we've accomplished only through serving you. Lord, we thank you that all that the NAACP has ever wanted is to be equal. We thank you, Lord, that we are all your children and that we all love to serve you. So we ask, Lord, that you bless this gathering tonight. We ask, Lord, that you bless the food and the hands that have prepared it. In our precious Son, Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I don't believe y'all said that lame. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
It's Friday. We are celebrating 100 years of the NAACP. That's cause for celebration. It is my honor to be here. My name is Sharon Howard with WDTN Television. Derek asked me to MC this several months ago, and I thought when I accepted that the only person I was going to have to answer to was Derek. But the whole stroll in here, I had 5 million people tell me, okay, are you going to keep this program on schedule? So I now realize I have at least 10 bosses, but Derek is the big boss. We are so thrilled that you all are here and joined us on your Friday evening to celebrate the NAACP. A couple of things I want to just make sure you all know. Because we are welcoming NAACPers from all over the state of Ohio, where are they? Are they in the house? Where are my Ohio NAACPers? Okay. They are in our city. They are having their conference at the Dayton Convention Center in the Crown Plaza, so we welcome you. And because they are here, President Forward is going to host a little post-party. So when you leave here tonight from 9 until midnight, there is going to be a party in one of the rooms on this floor. When you leave, it is open to everybody. That's kind of party, right? Everybody can stop at the party, so please come by. There will be a live band, and Derek will welcome all of you. We also want to thank our sponsor, Heidelberg, because they are providing liquid refreshments in the back of the room. Y'all know what that is, right? Liquid refreshments. We want to be mindful and polite to our, you know, brethren here, but they offered it up, and we thank them for that. To give you our official welcome, please welcome Mr. Omar Williams, who is the chair of the Freedom Fund Banquet of the NAACP.
Good evening, everyone. All right, are we here? Are we ready? All right. Well, first of all, I would like to thank each and every one of you for coming out to this auspicious occasion. I would like to thank you for your prayers, for your support, and all the things that you do on a daily basis that help the NAACP thrive and grow as it is under the leadership of President Derek L. Forward. I had the pleasure of going to one of the seminars yesterday. Dr. Percy Frazier was speaking, and Wilberforce alum, if he's here, me too. But he said something that was very profound, and he's an obstetrician, and he says that air is the spirit of life. And each time we take a breath of that air, we're breathing in life. So tonight, if you would all join me in taking a deep breath. Thank you. Because we're going to breathe some life into this organization under the leadership of President Derek L. Forward, and I'd like to thank you once again for coming out to this occasion, and have a good night. And right now, we should be looking forward to our video presentation from our national president in the national conference. Thank you.
My name is Ben Jealous, president and CEO of the NAACP. As a fifth generation card-carrying member of this great organization, I value and appreciate the hard work of local leaders and local supporters who come together to make sure again and again that this country, that our communities are transformed for the better. Not just for black people, not just for some people, but for all people. As we move forward into our second century, towards a destiny of good schools, good jobs, and a place beyond mass incarceration and nonsense about who can be the toughest on crime, when we need to strive to be the smartest in making all of our communities safer, I want to assure you that our friends on Capitol Hill and that our friends at the White House value and appreciate the transformative power of your hard work and of this great association. Thank you. Enjoy the celebration, and God bless.
Thank you all so much for allowing me to join you today. I'm pleased to help you commemorate this historic anniversary, and I'm so sorry I can't be there in person to express my profound gratitude to the NAACP as you mark this milestone. It is humbling to consider all that the NAACP has achieved over the course of a century. It's humbling to think of the progress made possible by ordinary folks who refused to settle for the world as it was and instead stood up and fought to remake the world as it should be. It's humbling to know that it is only because of the men and women of the NAACP, only because of those freedom riders and civil rights workers, those protesters, preachers, and teachers, that I can come before you as President of the United States. The men and women who started this work a century ago were united not by color, but by cause, their shared determination to secure for all people those rights that were only available to some. They understood that for those words put to paper by our founders to mean something for all our people, each new generation would have to breathe new life into them. For 100 years, that has been the mission at the heart of this organization's work, from integrating our schools and armed forces to passing the Voting Rights and Civil Rights Acts to fighting poverty and despair and working to lift up our communities. It's a responsibility each of us still bears today. For this moment of challenge for our nation, at the dawn of this organization's next century, we know that our work is nowhere near finished. We know that there are children to teach and jobs to create and cities to rebuild. There are still gaps to be closed and wrongs to be righted, and injustices that linger on from the last century to our own. Thurgood Marshall once said, "In recognizing the humanity of our fellow beings, we pay ourselves the highest tribute." For 100 years, the NAACP has pushed us to acknowledge the humanity in each other and to ensure that our laws would follow suit. You've inspired us to strive for that mountaintop, even when the climb seems steep. And for that, I honor you, I congratulate you, and I wish you another century of accomplishment as extraordinary as your first. Thank you so much.
We want to thank the Banquet Committee for working hard and securing a message from our national president of the NAACP, Benjamin Todd Jealous, and of course, the 44th president of the United States of America, Barack Obama. That's, yes. Good job, Derek. Here to bring greetings and presentations, the Honorable Ryan McClinn, Mayor of the City of Dayton.
Good evening, everyone, and it's a pleasure to have you in downtown Dayton. Welcome to the NAACP. All of our proclamations and greetings are listed in the program, but at this particular time, I am going to ask all elected officials that are on the state level to please stand. The county level to please stand. The township level, please stand. And the municipalities level to please stand. Let us give them a hand for service. And to be fair, since we are fortunate this time to have the president, the chairman of the Republican and the Democratic Party here, all those candidates that are running for office, regardless of what, whether it's municipal or township, please stand at this time. So, on behalf of the City of Dayton, my colleagues, Dean Lovelace, Joey Williams, Matt Joseph, and Nan Whaley, we say welcome to the NAACP's Freedom Fund Banquet and to your state convention.
Thank you, Mayor. The Mayor mentioned that we are bipartisan here this evening. We know that Election Day is November 3rd, but we're going to take a time out this evening. Please welcome Greg Gantt from the Republican Party and Mark Owens from the Democratic Party with bipartisan greetings. This should be interesting.
You know, we hear that a lot, but actually, Mark and I spend quite a lot of time together. And in fact, we have each other's cell phones in our speed dial. And tonight we were getting ready to line up, and I couldn't find Mark. And I was calling him saying, "Where are you?" And there he appeared. On behalf of the Montgomery County Republican Party, I'd like to congratulate the NAACP on its 100th anniversary and offer encouragement and continued pursuit of the organization's mission and vision. Husband, father, son, American, Ohioan, Daytonian, Flyer fan, these are all just adjectives that I could use to describe myself before I would mention that I'm chairman of the Republican Party. I trust that everyone here tonight has some association or connection with those adjectives I just listed. Too often in our political and social debates, we focus on our differences and forget about our similarities. I did some research in preparing for tonight and read several items about the Republican Party and the NAACP, and I found the following statements. To have equal protection under the law, to ensure that inalienable rights of all people cannot be voted away by a majority of voters, to ensure the political, educational, social, and economic equality of all citizens, to seek enactment and enforcement of federal, state, and local laws, to educate persons as to their constitutional rights, to stress liberty and rights as central values allowing citizens to be independent in their performance of civic duties. Can you guess which of those statements I found at a Republican website and which I found at the NAACP website? Does it matter? My message to you this evening is that it does not matter. The issues of our day demand our society requires us great cooperation, find common ground, and work together. One of my favorite quotes from former President Reagan is that my 80% friend is not my 20% enemy. And I truly believe that we must focus more on our common goals and our ideas than struggling with our differences all the time. Thank you. As a local party chairman, and I know my colleague Mark Owens feels this way as well, my focus is as an Ohioan, a Montgomery County resident, and a Daytonian. I look for the advancement and betterment of our community for all of our citizens, and I'm so pleased to be here with you tonight and share those ideas. Again, I want to congratulate and thank the NAACP for its dedication to these common hopes and dreams, and wish you continued success for the next 100 years.
Thank you, Greg. President Forward, members of the officers of the Dayton Unit of the NAACP, as the chairman of the Montgomery County Democratic Party, I am here to, first of all, congratulate the National NAACP on their 100th anniversary. Over the last 100 years, there has been great many struggles for equality, for rights, for civil rights, and there have been, frankly, a coalition of both Democrats and Republicans that helped make that possible. And sometimes our what we see today seems that's not possible. But if you look back in the 1960s, there was a Democratic president like Lyndon Johnson and a Republican Senate leader like Everett Dirksen that was able to push through the Civil Rights Acts of 64 and the Voting Rights Acts of 1965. It's a shame sometimes that we don't have that kind of bipartisan, cross the aisle cooperation today, but I truly believe on issues that are of importance to equal rights, to justice, and to human rights, the two parties can come together, will come together to make it right. I know even though you've been here for 100 years, the job is not done. And as Democrats and as Republicans, we will stand together to make sure the job is finished. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. That was quite impressive. I want to see both of y'all on November the 3rd. And I want you all to play nice on that day. I've been coming to the NAACP banquet for many, many years. And under Jesse Gooding's leadership, our next video message comes to a gentleman who came to Dayton many, many times to speak. And every time he came to speak, when he was done, the entire room was on their feet. We bring a video message from the Honorable Benjamin Hooks, former executive director and CEO of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People.
Hello. Good morning to all of you. God bless you. And thank you, Jesse Butler Grant, for that presentation. You may be seated, if you will, now, Chairman Bond and Mrs. Bond. Would you all stand? Give both of them a great big hand. Mrs. Bond has been right there. President Jealous and his lovely wife. Would you all stand just for a minute, if you're here? And then Rosalind Brock, would you stand just for a moment? Amen. God bless you. Now, you'll notice I'll be looking at my watch from time to time because I'm aware that I mean, fortunate on the president's time, I don't want to do that, so this 45-minute speech has been reduced quite a bit. Young man went to church with his father, and he noticed the preacher always looking at his watch. He said, Daddy, what does that mean? He said, well, son, he's a Catholic priest, he'll be through in 5 minutes. Methodist preacher, he'll be through at 12 noon no matter what's happening. Baptist preacher, it don't mean a thing. And I'm afraid that may be so here. Just this moment, I'd like to have Hazel Dukes to stand, Maxine Smith, Rosalind Brock, and Pat Hooks, and Max and Mildred von Roxborough, is she here? These ladies played an important part of my life. Hazel Dukes was my mentor. I was Rosalind Brock. She was my mentee. And of course, Maxine Smith was my contemporary. She headed the Memphis branch when I was at the national office. My pack, my lovely daughter, God bless her. And then Mildred von Roxborough, who's forgotten more about the NAACP than most of us will ever know. And then above all, or beyond all, Francis Louise Dancy Hooks. Fan of Francis. Rivers wide. And I can't step it. Love you, baby, and I can't help it. Come on, a great big hand for Francis and all of the hill. It is hard to imagine anything more lovely than a NAACP convention. And how I've enjoyed this great music, not only this year, but across these 16 years that I headed the association, and then the years of the others who headed it. You know, sometimes music can be out of place. I'm going to sing about freedom and somebody wants to sing Old Black Joe. You got to get your music lined up. Preacher noted for preaching against whiskey. Had my way, I'd take all the whiskey in the state of Tennessee and throw it in the river. Somebody made the mistake of saying amen, and that emboldened him. Said, if I had my way, I'd take all the whiskey in the United States and throw it in the river. That's a battle, preach. If I had my way, I'd take all the whiskey in the whole wide world, throw it in the river. Shall we sing? Choir director said, number 554, shall we gather at the river? So, we've gathered at the river. It is difficult to imagine what this nation would have been were it not for the NAACP. From 1909 to this present day, we have been involved positively in every issue affecting human and civil rights in this nation. I'm reminded of a story of some mice who were having a meeting. They could not organize because there was a great big cat who would eat them alive if he caught them. The mice were trying to decide what they should do. One young mouse spoke up and said, "What we need to do is to put a bell on that cat's tail. So when the cat came, the bell would give away and we could get out of the way." And they all said, "That's a wonderful idea. Now who's going to put the bell on the tail?" In a sense, that has been the job of NAACP. Whether facing the cat of lynching, restrictive covenants, the cat of unequal pay, the cat of mob violence, the cat of the inability to vote, the cat of not being able to serve in the armed forces, the cat of not being able to find employment, unequal treatment by whites, separate but equal, the cat of segregated restrooms, railroad cars, and public transportation, we have been the mouse that belled the cat. And let me change that analogy. For not only have we belled the cat, but in many instances we have killed the cat. We're not mice. We are strong men and strong women. And the cat represents evil everywhere. We are soldiers in the army. We have to fight, although we have to cry. Not soldiers of war, bloodshed, violence, but soldiers of peace and justice, soldiers of legal battles and congressional legislation, soldiers of nonviolence, but nevertheless, soldiers. And we are committed to our cause. We've got to hold up the bloodstained banner of justice. We've got to hold it up until we die. Yes, we bell the cat of unequal schools with the Brown versus Board of Education decision. Thurgood Marshall, Charles Hamilton Houston, the greatest civil rights lawyers who ever lived. We bell the cat of segregated public transportation when Rosa Parks, Secretary of the Montgomery Branch, sat down that we might stand up. Yes, we testified for over 50 years against lynching. We bell the cat in the sweat case in Detroit. Black doctor brought her home and the mob crowd tried to run him out and a white man was killed. Clarence Darrow, the greatest lawyer of his time, represented the NAACP, won the verdict, and proved that a black man could defend himself in his household. We destroyed the cat of restrictive covenants. We destroyed the cat of a navy that did not allow black men or women to serve. And we produced a Samuel Gravely who not only became an admiral commanding a warship, but commanding the whole United States fleet. Samuel Gravely, Lyndon Elaine Fishburne. We conquered the army, which kept us down. And Henry Stenson said, "We didn't have enough sense to be soldiers." But think about a Colin Powell. Think about a Chappie Jane. Think about a Benjamin O. Davis. Yes, we've even flown the friendly skies with these men who proved we can make it. We bailed a cat of unequal treatment by unions in the early days with A. Philip Randolph leading the struggle. Thank God, the unions are now our strongest allies. Prior to the historic election of 2008, people said we could never bail the cat of having a black person as president. A young man by the name of Barack Obama stood in Springfield, Illinois, one cold day and said, "Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we can bell that cat." Or I could call the names, Jim Brown, and Kirk Flood, and Arthur Ashe, and Magic Johnson, John O. Franklin, Dorothy Height, Marsha Maxwell, Hazel Duke, Hazel O'Leary, Patricia Harris, Maxine Smith, Althea Simmons, Ophrey Winfield, Robert Johnson, Percy Sutton, Martin King, Francis Hicks, Roy Wilkins, Walter White, Mary Bethune, and the Bingham Brothers, and Mildred Roxburgh, Constance Baker Motley. I could call so many names, Douglas Wilder, Jesse Turner, Bishop William Graves, and Ben Hook. We all bell the cats. Annie Aponte Curtis, who's still belling the cats. And now, we've got a new CO. And Brother Jealous, there's still some cats to be built. Stand up, Ben. Stand up, Ben, and stand up, lovely wife, and say to him, we're going to be with you all the way. Not a part of the way, but all the way. Well, NAACP of today, are there no more cats to bell? No foes for us to face? Must we be carried to the skies on flowery beds of ease, while others fought to win the prize? Sailed through bloody seas. Fight on, not with bullets, bombs, and swords, but with truth and justice and righteousness. Fight on until the cast of apathy, ignorance, poverty, and prejudice is the bell. Fight on, fight on. Yes, NAACP, there are still cats to bell. Think of all the famous black stars and athletes making millions of dollars and won't give a dime to the cause. They got to be belled. They got to be belled. They got to be told. Think of all of the black young men and women who are serving now as heads of major corporations, and some of them have forgotten where they came from. Think about a talk show host, nationally known, on television, hoping that Barack Obama would fail. Think about a political party who spends all of their time in doing nothing and saying nothing, and most of them trying to destroy that which has been. But think of those cats who claim that Barack Obama is not even a United States citizen. Think about the cats. As soon as he was elected, he was no longer a black man. He was mostly white. Think about all the cats we've had to fail. Yes, think about the cat of the Supreme Court. Clarence Thomas is there, but we need somebody who not only thinks about America, but we need somebody who recognizes black Americans need still some help because we've been mistreated too long. Let's stop it right away. My mother and my father were soldiers. They had their hands on the gospel plow. One day they got tired and threw it to us and said, struggle on till you die. The jailhouse can't lock us out. Billy Club can't beat us out. Dynamite can't bum us out. Fire hoses can't wash us out. The dogs can't bite us out. The mob can't throw us out. My brothers and sisters, as I close today, let us stop fighting with one another and start working with one another. Hear me now. Let us not antagonize one another, but love one another. Let us not point fingers of division and discord. Rather, let us band together, moving toward a better America. When we move forward and say, God bless America, that's what it means. Then shall the kingdoms of this world, the city of New York and everywhere, shall become the kingdom of God. God shall reign and we shall rejoice, not in a utopian vision, but a practical design, that the words of Lincoln shall endure, that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from the earth. Let's fight on until justice rolls down like water. Let's fight on until righteousness comes in the mighty stream. Let's fight on until there's no downsizing. Let us fight on until there is no glass ceiling. Fight on until God shall stand at the four corners of the earth and tell the wind, wind, blow no more. Rain, fall no more. Thunder, roar no more. Lightning, flash no more. Waves of the sea, be still. Soldiers, come on now, and let's fight on, fight on. After a while, hey, after a while, God's gonna call children home. After a while, God's gonna call his children home. After a while. Fight on! Fight on! Fight on! Fight on! Yes! Bishop Gray. Hey, fighter! In the morning! In the morning! When the trumpet of God shall sound! In the morning!
Benjamin Hooks. You all didn't know you were going to have church tonight, did you? Church is good any day. I want to personally, as I call him Forward, personally congratulate President Derek Forward. I was just chatting with him during the video, and I was looking out because he, you know, Derek wants his events to be perfect. And he said, Sharon, what's the crowd look like? I said, it's a crowd. He said, are there any empty seats? I said, I don't see any, Derek. And so then I asked him, I said, you must have raised a lot of money. He said they raised the most money this year, and much of that has to do with the honorary chairs that Derek selected. Here to introduce our first honorary chair, Derek Forward.
Good evening. Good evening. We're celebrating 100 years of civil rights service. Can you say this with me? We. That's not a strong we. We are 100. We are 100. All right. The NAACP, we're live, strong, and well. We would like to thank all of you for coming out this evening, making this 100th anniversary a very, very well, nice event. It's because of people like you that come out on a day-to-day basis fighting for civil rights of all Americans. If you had an opportunity to look inside of your book, you will see that on February the 12th, 1909, that the NAACP was founded by a multiracial group of individuals striving to eliminate racial hatred and racial discrimination among all Americans. A multiracial group of individuals. If you look on the far, on the other page, you're going to see those founders. You're going to see those founders. And it's because of people like you. And what I like to do is, if you, all these people on the dais, if you are a life member of this prestigious organization, as I look to my right, as I look to my left, if you are a life member or a subscribing life member of this great association, please rise to your feet. Can you please rise to your feet? This is strength. Sister Ford, you're a life member, aren't you? Please rise. As I see these individuals standing, this reminds me of what the NAACP was all about. When I think about the Civil Rights Act of 1964 that was passed, when I think about the Voting Rights Act of 1965 that was passed, when I think about the Fair Housing Act of 68 that was passed, it was passed because a multiracial group of people like this on this dais who understood that all Americans need to have their civil rights. And these individuals have invested money, resources, and the understanding that all Americans will continue to pursue higher opportunities, higher education opportunities, higher job opportunities, all the different opportunities that everyone else has an opportunity to enjoy. Everyone, whether that you're black, you're white, you're yellow, you're red. We want to make certain that we all have same opportunities, just like the healthcare system. I know there's a big debate about it, but outside of that big debate, at the end of the day, people who are making a lot of money and people who are barely making it, everybody needs to have affordable healthcare. And I want people to really understand. So I'd like for people to really understand that it's because of people like you who invested in this organization that we are able to stand here tonight and celebrate 100 years. I don't know too many organizations that has 100. I don't know too many people that made it to be 100 years old. Is there a table 100 out here? If you're a table, if there's a table 100 out here, can you rise and make some noise? That's right, State University over there, college chapter, mentoring our youth. 100 years, 100 tables for this organization. You all may be seated, thank you. Our honorary co-chairs this evening, we have two. One you will hear from a little later, and the other you will hear following my presentation. And the first honorary co-chair is Dr. Daniel J. Kern. And it reads, in recognition of being the honorary chairperson at the Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet, October 23rd, 2009, signed by Omar Williams, Chair, Derek Ford, President. And the bottom of it says, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the NAACP. And here to accept on Dr. Daniel J. Kern, who's the president of the University of Dayton, to here to accept on his behalf is the provost, none other than Dr. Saliba. Thank you, sir. Right. Before I introduce my other honorary co-chair, because when I turn it over to him and hand this plaque to him, then we're going to turn the mic over to him. But as everybody knows, I work for Speedway Super America. I've been working there for the past 16 plus years and have had a great career. But I would not be able to do what I do with the NAACP if it was not for a company who believes in living their values. And that's what Speedway Super America believes in, living their values. I have a award here that I want to give to Dulce Hurst. Dulce, can you come, please? She is the manager of diversity and compliance for Speedway Super America. Yes, I have to give her some appreciation. And I know she was not expecting this. I was trying to do this up in the VIP room, but I didn't see her. So I want to get it out the way here. And at the end of the day, it still becomes, you gotta have companies that are understanding of the mission of the NAACP and that are doing things out inside the community. And I'm just humbled that my company has allowed me to serve. That is one thing that really makes my heart feel good, that they allowed me to serve. So this right here, I'm gonna do something.
Wow.
What this says, it says, Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet, Community Outreach Award, presented to Speedway Super America LLC in recognition of living your values by promoting employee involvement in the community to enhance the quality of life of all Americans. October 23rd, 2009, signed by Omar Williams, Chair, Derek L. Ford, President. Thank you, Dulce, for everything that you do. So at this time, I'd like to introduce the other honorary co-chair. And that is by ways of Vail K. Miller, Jr. In recognition for being the honorary chairperson at the Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet, October 2009, signed by Omar J. Williams, Derek O. Ford, President, Mr. Miller, can you come up, please? Vail Miller, we had an opportunity. First of all, we have a we have established a very good work relationship. Basically, I met Vail working for Speedway, and he is the CEO of Heidelberg. So we had an opportunity to look at things from a business perspective, as well as develop a friendship down through the years. And Vail is gonna unveil to you this evening something that him and I had talked about doing at this banquet this year in the 100th year of the NAACP. So Vail, I appreciate you, and here's your award, thank you.
Good evening. Well, I want to talk a little bit about family. So
something we can all identify with. And I'm a fourth generation family member in our business, started 71 years ago by my great-grandfather. And if it wasn't for my family, as well as my Heidelberg family, and they were up here clapping earlier, the Heidelberg family, but there's a gentleman to my right, Mr. Richard Wall, a member of my family who has been an outstanding leader but a mentor to me as I've grown up in this business. And as Derek and I were talking about this great celebration, I wanted to do something special to honor this man, Mr. Richard Wall. So we created the Outstanding Corporate Leadership Award, and I'd like to present that to Mr. Richard right now.
Richard.
Now you can check out page 47 in the book. Talks a lot about his life and some of his loves and his outstanding leadership. Richard Wall. It says, in recognition of 39 years of loyal, dedicated, and influential service at Heidelberg Distributing Company, always remember, this bud's for you.
Thank you very much, Bill. Appreciate it. Heidelberg has been very good to me. Been there 39 years. I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to stay there until the Lord takes me. So he's going to let me stick around a while. Thank you.
Please welcome the third vice president for the Dayton unit of the NAACP, Mr. Brian Dunson, who is going to make our life members' presentations. Please welcome Brian Dunson. Welcome, Brian Dunson.
Good evening. Good evening. It's been a fabulous year for lifetime memberships. Our previous high was 28 last year. This year, we got 44. So I want to thank everyone who became life members. Give yourselves a round of applause. And if you're not a life member, please see me. I'm the third vice president. I'll be sitting over here. Okay? I'm going to announce the names. Now I want to preface this by saying since we had so many life memberships come in, we weren't able to get all the plaques in at one time. So we're going to be giving some people certificates like myself. And when the plaques come in, you will get that as soon as possible. So I want you to come up and we'll start that off right now. Gwendolyn Holmes. Gwendolyn Holmes. Okay. Oh, look at my man right there. Gregory A. Brush. My man David Clapper. Dr. Richard Wydersky. And when you receive your plaques, please stand up. Stay here. We're going to take a photo at the end. Richard Wall. Mr. Wall, Mr. Nickname Fly. Daphne Baines. Michael Parks. The Honorable Fred Strayhorn. Douglas A. Fetcher, Dr. Berkwood M. Farmer, David Jones, Jeffrey Stalzenberg, F&S Motorcycle Sales Incorporated, Karen Bowl, Arnetta Gary, retired Major Odell W. Graves, Dr. David H. Ponitz, Dr. Doris Ponitz, Madam Jean Forward, hope I'm pronouncing this correctly. Jean Forward and Dr. Gloria Forward. You got another one. All the Forwards, just life members. I'll just say that. Tania Bailey, University of Dayton, Dr. Daniel Curran, Linda Hoffman, Junior Life Rahee Stansfield, Junior Life Christopher Perkins Jr., Derek. Brian E. Dunson, John T. Donnellan, Natasha Williams, retired Judge Patrick Foley, Anthony Whitmore, Stephen Mitchell, Dr. Stephen Johnson, Sinclair Community College, Dr. David Smith, Five Rivers Metro Park, Deborah Jackson, Dr. David Hopkins, Wright State University, Archie Dean Johnson, Thomas Fedor, President of Central State University, John W. Garland, and two junior lights, Michaela Sloan and Denzel Hollis. Please give them a round of applause. and Judge Deidre Logan. These are our life members for the year 2009. Again, if you're not a life member, please contact me. I'll be sitting right here, third vice president and membership chairperson. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Brian is waiting for your checks.
Sit down, Earl. Sheldon Mitchell and Steve Smith. And Steve's your brother, Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. We recognize that. A five.
Have we missed anybody else? Ladies and gentlemen, our life members 2009. Michaela Sloan. Okay, she's a life member. Why don't you meet her up here, Derek? It's important that during the service of the NAACP that we are mindful of young people. The Dayton unit has a very active youth program, and here with recognition of youth achievements, we had Carolyn Perkins, followed by Jane Frower and Linda Bowles. Please welcome Carolyn Perkins.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the 100th celebration of the NAACP. And as always, with most civic and civil rights organizations, it's the young people that lead the way. They're the legs of the organization. They're the ones that do all the footwork. And this year, we've been in process of restructuring, and things are in place right now. They've been fortunate to be given the honor of going to the inauguration of the President of the United States in January. And they also, through donations and a lot of hard work on their part, they earned money and we begged for money. And they also got to the 100th National Convention in New York City. But these bunch of young folks work hard. It says in the book, they work hard and they play hard. And you can't expect any more than that. The only thing that I expect out of the youth is that they try their best and they use their manners. Because so many times we have young folks that get all the notoriety for the sagging pants, short dresses, whatever. But these young folks are really striving to become something and their leadership. The president of the Youth Council is D'Angelo Bird, sitting to my left on the dais. Rajay Perkins, that had the lifetime membership, he's the treasurer. Destiny Blake is the secretary. Denzel Hollis is the first vice. And we have a couple other members. I can't see where they were. Table number 37, you want to stand up? This is the future of our organization. Give them all a hand. Thank you.
My name is Jean Ford. I'm the advisor of the Little John Junior Youth Council, and I am just here to introduce our new president, Michaela Sloan.
This is an award that goes to a very hardworking and inspiring woman. She followed in her father's footsteps into politics, and she inspired me when she came to talk to me in my youth group and many other places. She's very environmentally cautious, and this award says that in honor of goodness, generosity, strength, and caring, inspiration to our children makes you a woman to be admired and respected. Dedication to Dayton and the community. Our own Mayor Ryan McGlynn. I'll send this reward on her behalf. She had to leave.
Good evening. My name is Linda Bowles, and I chair the AXO program along with Dr. Moeller. Dr. Moeller, will you come forward, please? Also, Sharita Wind and Marlene Johnson. Marlene Johnson is an advisor, the lead advisor, and Sharita Wind is my secretary. And we are the AXO program, which we strive to mentor students in the areas of the sciences, the humanities, the performing arts, the visual arts, and entrepreneurship. Will my 9 gold medalists come forward, please? Each year, we have students that are participating in the national program of the AXO program, and this year we had 9 students who participated nationally. They are Michelle Anderson, sculpture and photography, Sydney Dunson, poetry, James Edwards Kenyon, music instrumental classical and music instrumental contemporary, Prentice Haney, filmmaking video, Malcolm Keith Jr., computer science, Megan Mobley, music vocal contemporary, Isaac Tobler, who is not here today, he had a prior engagement, music vocal classical, Danielle Watkins. Is Danielle's mother here, Marianne? Okay, great. She's accepting the award for her daughter because her daughter could not be here tonight. And Mr. Travion Wilson, who could not be here as well. He was our gold medalist in drama. This year, we had 1 national gold medal in computer science, and that was Mr. Malcolm Keith Jr. Is Mr. Malcolm Keith's mother and father here, Melanie Bush, and Mr. Malcolm Keith Sr.? Would you come forward, please? We'd like to thank the students who participated in the national AXO program and received gold medals locally. They did a superb job at the national level, and we'd like to thank them for doing that. Thank you.
Ms. Bowles, we have a surprise for you. Look, you can see it in her face. Turn around so everybody can see. She's like, how did I lose control? Welcome David Clapper from the Standard Register Company, and he has a surprise for Linda Bowles.
Good to see you.
Ready? Standard Register has a very distinct privilege of helping sponsor the youth programs for the NAACP. And I had the very distinct honor of judging the AXO program. And under President Ford's administration and my friend, they have been able to bring back national recognition from the back into Dayton for these very, very talented young people. Well, on behalf of me personally, I know that Linda puts out her own money to be able to make sure that these young people have the opportunity to be able to go to the national event. So on behalf of me personally, I would like to please a round of applause for what Linda does and for what this great program does for these young people.
David, what a great surprise.
She's a great lady. She's a great woman.
Thank you so much. I was not aware of this. This is, came as a complete surprise. I'm so thankful for this, Mr. Clapper, and God bless you and your company. I'd like for you to take a picture with the group, Mr. Clapper. Thank you.
And David, the next time you bring a check, you can come up to the second tier. Thank you. Thank you, David Clapper, Standard Register, for supporting the NAACP Youth Program. Very quickly, I want to bring someone up to the podium. I'm sure she's been running around crazy for the last couple of days with the conference, but I would like to give an opportunity for her to bring you a couple of words to say welcome and to say hello to Dayton, the Honorable Sybil Edwards McNabb, President of the Ohio Conference of the NAACP. Big Dayton, welcome.
Good evening. It is my extreme pleasure to be here in celebration with the Dayton, Ohio unit of the NAACP, doing what they always do well in celebration of 100 years, but every year the Dayton unit puts forth or has an outstanding banquet, and it is very obvious under the leadership of Mr. Forward, which has this theme, move forward with Forward, and he really brings it into a reality. He's been an asset to the Ohio Conference. He came on board of no nonsense, very aggressive, but committed to the job, and we thank him. We also thank that the wonderful committees that have hosted us thus far, and even as we go into our last day of actual workshops and presentations, we take this opportunity to invite each of you on tomorrow evening. We are so blessed to have our national president and CEO, Benjamin Todd Jealous, the youngest president of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Tomorrow we will be doing a first for the state of Ohio, for we will be hosting an Act So Gala. These young people that were just up here are a tip of the iceberg of what happens not only across the state of Ohio, but across this country. They're not our future, they're our present. And if we don't invest in them, if we don't promote them, then the 100 years that we're looking forward to cannot happen. So again, I bring you greetings from the Ohio Conference and from the NAACP, which is the oldest and the strongest civil rights organization. I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge Kevin Boyd, which will be our speaker tonight, is a dear friend of mine. Good to see you, and God bless each one.
I would like for our national board member, Ophelia Averett, to come up. She is also the president of the Akron unit of the NAACP. but she's also a national board member. And she's a national board member as the chair of the Life Memberships. And that's where I really got my zest and zeal from, to go out there and secure these Life Memberships, you know, through the efforts of Ophelia Avery. But I wanted you to stand up here with me as I present this to our state president. Because our state president travels across this state. Don't get paid a dime, but travels across this state to help all Americans in situations where other people where they don't have a voice to speak for themselves. But she's also very instrumental in our youth. So with that, here's an award we're gonna give her that says Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet Youth Empowerment Award, presented to the Honorable Sybil Edwards McNabb, in recognition of your profound leadership in providing opportunity for youth to serve the NAACP and their communities with passion and excellence. October 23rd, 2009, signed Omar Williams, Derek Ford. Congratulations, President McNabb.
You know what, Derek? He's talking about you gotta make up 2 minutes. He's the one that's got his 2 minutes off track. Please welcome, I always get excited to introduce this gentleman because even though he is so fabulous with the NAACP, he's special to me because I tell everybody he's my teacher. He was one of my teachers and I love him to death. Here to present some very well-deserved scholarships, Willie Terrell.
I know most of you are good evening out, but good evening. Will the scholarship recipients come down, please? And I will share some information about each of you. But before I do that, my name is Willie A. Terrell Jr., and I would like to thank you for supporting the NAACP Souvenir Journal. I chaired that book, and you helped me make that book the biggest yet. So thank you and give yourself a hand. And I also would like for you to support those people that supported the NAACP. So take a look at the book, and when you decide to spend your money or consider an issue, please take a look in the book and see and support those that supported us. Also, I want to give a special thanks to the audience. A year ago, I stood before you asking for your support of issue 52. The NAACP supported that issue and you backed it with your vote. So again, thank you for supporting issue 52 for our children. Okay, now we're ready to recognize our scholarship recipients. We need our president down front and our 18th president, Jesse Goody. And also, parents, we are proud of you too. So the parents of our scholarship recipients, please come down front too. Our first recipient is Sherelle Garrett. Sherelle is a student at Dunbar. Grade point average, 3.7. And the interesting thing about Sherelle, she is a cheerleader and Jeff Mims, she plans on being a future teacher. Lori Ward, she plans on being a future teacher. Also, she volunteers, and most of you know, October is breast cancer awareness. She has walked and supported cancer awareness. So let's give Sherelle a hand. The parents of Sherelle, please get with her so you can get a photo op with her. Also, Brother Ford, President Ford, there are some checks down there. Please pick up Sherelle's check and see if she can cash it. Jesse get over there with her with the check. And Sherelle is the recipient of the Laverne Gooding Scholarship. Laverne was before me, she was in charge of the scholarships for the NAACP, and she is the deceased wife of Jesse Gooding. Okay, our next scholarship recipient is James Edward Kenyon. James is a student at Stivers, and James' average is 3.84. And as you notice, we keep going up. And one that wrote a recommendation for James said he's known James since he was 5 years old. So James is our Michael Jackson. He is very, very talented, has won many awards. Thank you, the parents of James. And he's the recipient of the Jesse O. Gooding Scholarship. Congratulations, James. Okay, our next recipient is Tessa. Tessa Terrell, she's a student at DECA, and as you know, the averages keep going up. Her average is 4.0. And she is going to University of Dayton. Also, Tessa is also one of our only recipients that are taking college credit at this time and receiving college credit at local university. And I want to apologize. Tessa is the recipient of the Laverne Gooding Scholarship, and Sherelle was the recipient of the Molly O. Williams Scholarship. Each of these three individuals received $1,000, and all they need to do is show proof of graduation and what college that they were accepted to, or college or university that they will be attending. Okay, our next recipient, and we need Mark Walton, Vice President of Fifth Third Private Banking, to come forward to assist in this honor. Our president, Derek Ford, who is a very visionary leader, came up with the idea that we should create another scholarship. And most of you have been to our scholarship programs before. We started off with Jesse, then we added Laverne and Jesse, and then we had Miley, Jesse, and Laverne. Now we have the Derek L. Ford MCE Visionary Leadership Scholarship. And we'll, Mark, do you want to come to the podium and give us some comments, please? Come on, Mark, because my student just hit me.
I was told for the $5,000 that we provided, I could come to the second tier. Is that all right? All right. Well, good evening. My name is Mark Walton, and I am Vice President and Head of Fifth Third Bank's Private Banking Group in Greater Dayton. I'd like to take this time to tell you how proud we are to support the NAACP Freedom Fund Banquet and to underwrite the inaugural Derek L. Ford Visionary Leadership Scholarship. Transforming our community through a shared vision, equality for all Americans, bold dreams, big victories. This is the tagline for your NAACP chapter. At Fifth Third Bank, we've always believed that building a stronger community builds a stronger bank. We also believe that the money and resources we invest in the community today makes an immediate impact while creating the conditions for a better, stronger, and more viable tomorrow. We are committed to investing the time, the resources, and the people to build strong communities. As a sponsor, Fifth Third Bank encourages everyone to help support the mission and the vision of the NAACP, helping to transform our community through a shared vision focused on equality for all Americans. Thank you for letting us be a part of tonight's event, and have a terrific evening.
And as I said earlier, the averages kept going up and up, and the recipient of the Derek L. Ford Visionary Scholarship is Olivia Wilson, 4.2, a student at Meadowdale. Thank you.
Give all of our young people who received an award a proud round of applause. I'm going to ask Ken Solfridge from AFSCME Local 101 to come forward. Where is Ken? Oh, there's Ken. You can just scoot right up here. Thank you. Please welcome Ken. He is here with a presentation from Labor.
Just a second. We have a basket. Let me grab the basket. I'll be right back.
We got it. What did he say? What did he say, you all? Oh, geez. You bring gifts.
It's a tribute to Dr. King.
It's beautiful. Can you hold it up?
Good evening, sisters and brothers. I'm Ken Solfridge, president of AFSCME Local 101. And this is Marcia Knox, the regional director for Ohio Council 8. Stacy Benson is the staff rep for Ohio Council 8. And we're also proud members of the NAACP Dayton region. We are here tonight to recognize one of the community leaders we have in Dayton with this tribute to Dr. King. Dr. King believed that justice at the bargaining table could help break the cycle of poverty. Dr. King lost his life in Memphis, Tennessee, April 4th, 1968, while supporting striking members of AFSCME Local 1733 in their fight to win union recognition for city sanitary workers. For him, civil rights and union rights were two sides of the same economic coin. These rights would improve lives for workers on the job and at home. The person that AFSCME is recognizing tonight for his work to help build that dream is Derek Ford. Thank you. I think we got him.
Thank you, AFSCME Local 101. Thank you. Our three final awards are the most prestigious that the Dayton unit gives out. I'm going to ask Reverend Herman Branham to come forward first and ask that Jesse Gooding and Derek come to the podium, and they will follow Reverend Branham.
Good evening. Hope you all have dined sufficiently. I have the honor and the task to present this prestigious award to a recipient by the name of Reverend Renee Shepherd. And if you look on page 49 in your book, it has her bio. Because of the time, we are somewhat behind. We are going to make this very quick. But it's certainly, I would like to say it to her, according to her bio, you know, she is one who has worked very hard and tirelessly. And Reverend Shepherd is also the pastor of Away Apostolic Church located here in Dayton, Ohio. She is the widow of the late Bishop Dr. Robert Shepherd. They have two daughters, Robin Renee Blatters, a middle school teacher, and Rosanna Marie Baker, a registered nurse. Two grandchildren, Thomas Baker and Julia Baker. You know, there's scripture in Psalms 27:14 verse that says, wait on the Lord and be of good courage, and he shall renew thy strength. And when I looked at her bio, from all that she has accomplished, I'm sure you know, because of a patient and waiting on him, now we see where he has really worked in her life and allowed her to really just be a great asset here in the Dayton, in the city of Dayton, Ohio, and where persons have really been helped through her ministries and through all her many services. And it's indeed an honor and a great, great respect that we, the Dayton Unit NAACP, on this date, Friday, October 23rd, 2009, in celebration of our 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet, recognize Reverend Renee Shepherd for remarkable professionalism as a community activist, supporting the vision, mission, goals, and objectives of the NAACP. She has distinguished herself as a great leader who has aroused and has a conscience of the nation in the Dayton, Ohio community. This time we'd like Renee Shepherd to please come.
I'm just so humble and grateful to receive this award. I'm thanking God for all the people that are here today and all the people that I have been involved with. And I'm just so glad to see Phyllis Lovelace here. She's been such a wonderful person helping her husband during his time of illness. And I'm just thanking God for all his goodness.
This award is for Mr. Willie Terrell.
Okay, Jesse cannot see this, so that's why I'm here. Meritorious Service Award presented to Willie A. Terrell, Jr., in recognition of your loyal and dedicated service to the Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet.
Giving honor to God, and I'd like to also thank my parents, Willie A. Terrell Sr. and Hazel Wright Terrell. They gave me my foundation. They are at table 76. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, hello, my name is D'Angelo Bird. I am the president of the NAACP Youth Council, and we have a special award here for Reverend Renee Shepherd. This lady, she helps us out a lot out of her time. If it's a car wash, if it's a dinner, she's always there, and we really do appreciate this. It says you fly under the radar, but you're appreciated.
All right, I have the distinct honor of presenting the President's Award. And we'll try to get us back on track here. I think we're behind 4.5 minutes. So this particular President's Award goes to an individual who has been a rock, not only inside of the neighborhood that I live in, but inside of the community. It's those unsung heroes that people sometimes don't often see, but they touch you with that quiet peace, and they actually give you an opportunity to embrace life. So Paul Miller Sr., if you could come up here for a second. Paul A. Miller Sr. This plaque reads, Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet President's Award, presented to Paul A. Miller Sr. for your inspiring, motivating, and encouraging words of wisdom. No matter what the occasion, you have shared knowledge and given your resources to ensure others succeed and enjoy life. As I look at you eyeball to eyeball, I'm here to tell you I love you riding or walking. You are a friend indeed. October 23rd, 2009. I told Sharon I was on track. I said I had 4.5 minutes. I have another just quick special award, and it says, I don't see the person in here. So this is an award to, it's a President's Award of Merit. And it says, presented to Dr. Sharon R. Johnson, in recognition of your exemplary and unselfish leadership that has inspired me to persevere through times of challenge, rise above the storms of life, and keep unwavering faith in God until victory is won. You have not only inspired your siblings to pursue higher educational opportunities, but also your immediate family and many others. Continue to lead with excellence and keep our mother's dream alive of educating the world through International Apostolic University of Grace and Truth. Our love is forever. This is presented to my sister. She was down here, but I don't see her at the present time. But please, sister, I love you, and you need to know that. Thank you.
I just have one question. After all those awards, I can't believe I didn't get one. I don't know how that happened, dear. And then I didn't even get to eat dinner. Okay, it's coming. All right. We have come to the point in the program where we get to sit back and hear greetings from a very special guest speaker. I would like to, I told him I would have his back. So let me just say this. We all know that the flu is going around. And we are so lucky and so fortunate that Kevin Boyce came here, and he is truly not well. He's been drinking tea all night. He's been going off of the podium, but he wants to make it. He said, I'm going to give it the college try. How about the Ohio State Buckeye try? He's going to do it. He's going to do it. So we need you all to give him encouragement when he gets up here, because he's really not feeling well. Here to introduce our guest speaker, though, is the Provost of the University of Dayton, Joe Saliba.
Good evening. On behalf of our President Dan Curran, who couldn't be with us tonight, it is indeed my honor and my privilege to introduce our keynote speaker, the Honorable Kevin L. Boyce. Boyce was sworn in as the 47th Treasurer of the State of Ohio on January 7, 2009. Boyce, a Columbus native, was raised by his mother and his grandmother, who taught him that hard work and responsibility create opportunity to succeed in life. It is upon this foundation that Boyce has based his social and political philosophies. He developed an understanding of the importance of serving one's community, and even more importantly, the belief that everyone should have opportunities for success in life, and each of us has a role in making tomorrow a better world. Prior to his appointment as treasurer, Boyce served 8 years as a member of the Columbus City Council, of which the last 3 years he was selected as president pro tempore and served as chairman of the Public Finance Committee. During his tenure on council in Columbus, he established a record of fiscal integrity, performance-based budget practices, and oversaw the adoption of the city's $1.3 billion annual budget. Additionally, Boyce founded the Columbus Youth Commission, significantly expanded parkland and greenways, advocated for stronger civil rights laws, and championed job creation strategies that led to the creation or retention of more than 20,000 jobs in Central Ohio. Boyce has received many awards and honors, of which I only will include few. First is the Ebony's Magazine's National Award, 30 Leaders Under 30, the National Council of Negro Women's Community Service Award, the Society of Black Professionals Achievement Award, and many, many others. In 2009, he was honored by Wilberforce University with an honorary Doctor of Humane Letters degree for his distinguished career in public service, commitment to community, and dedication to higher education. Boyce earned a bachelor's degree in political science from University of Toledo and master's degree in public administration from Central Michigan University. It is indeed my honor and my privilege to present to you the Honorable Kevin L. Boyce.
We told you all we were having church tonight, so you know how we do in the church. We have a musical selection, and please welcome Jennifer Matthews Coulter. Please welcome Jennifer Coulter.
Thank you, Sharon. Good evening. It is my pleasure to be here to minister unto you, and I hope that this song will encourage you to hold on, no matter how hard the struggle might get, having done all, to stand. Seems like you can't make it through. nothing left to do. You just stand, watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all that you can, you just stand. How do you handle the guilt of your past? Tell me, how do you deal with the shame? Oh, and how can you smile when your heart has been broken and filled with pain? So much pain. Tell me, what do you do when you've given your all and it seems like you can't make it through? Child, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You just stand and watch the Lord see you through. Done all that you can, just stand and be sure. Be not entangled in that bondage again. You just stand and endure.
Just saying to me, now that's how you get introduced. I like to travel with that kind of audience sometimes. You'll have to forgive me tonight, struggling a little bit with my voice. I'm not going to let you down. Celebration is far too important, and we've come far away. The Bible says that it's good and pleasant when brethren dwell in unity. It's like the precious ointment upon the beard, even Aaron's beard that went down to the skirts of his garment. As the dew of Hermon and as the dew that descended upon the mountain of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing and even life forevermore. It is such an honor to be here with the Dayton chapter of the NAACP and the great work that Mr. Derek Forward is doing here in the city of Dayton, in the county of Montgomery, and in the state of Ohio. Give him another round of applause for his work. I'm so grateful to get to know Derek and his work here in Dayton, but also thank you to Sharon Howard, to Joe Saliba for the wonderful introduction. And I'd be remiss tonight if I didn't take a moment to recognize my colleague in state office, Secretary of State Jennifer Bruner is with us this evening. Give her a round of applause for me, people. Thank you. Finally, to Mayor McClinn, my good friend, State President of the NAACP, Sybil McNabb, and all of the wonderful dais guests that are here today, I am so honored to be a part of 100 years of impact of the NAACP in America and 58 years right here in the city of Dayton. Give the NAACP another round of applause for their wonderful work and leadership. He said it's 96 years. Thank you very much. Each day in Africa, as the sun rises, a lion and a gazelle awaken. Now, the lion instinctively knows that it must be faster than the slowest gazelle, or it'll starve and die. The gazelle intuitively knows that it must be faster than the fastest lion, or it'll be killed and eaten. The bottom line, when the sun comes up each day, you better be prepared to run. And isn't that what life is really all about? Preparing ourselves for the choices that we have, but even more importantly, the decisions that we make. 2008 was a tremendous year for America, and indeed I say the world. We all witnessed the election of the first African-American president of the United States of America, in Barack Hussein Obama. And while he brought a message of change and hope to America and indeed to the world, my claim to fame is that I actually got to know Barack Obama last year on a personal and close level. And you know, we all have ulterior motives many times when we're getting to know people like Barack Obama. But I gotta tell you, I had some serious ulterior motives. When Barack Obama was running for president as the United States Senator, I was one of the first people, one of the first elected officials in the state of Ohio to endorse Barack Obama. Okay, round of applause for that. Thank you very much. Yes, that's right, that's right. Not only did I have the insight, but I had the guts to do it too. But it put me in a good position to get to learn and understand and know Barack Obama as a potential future president. And I can remember when I had endorsed him, I'd get calls from the campaign when he was coming to town, and they would say, Councilman Boyce, I was on city council at the time, they'd say, Councilman Boyce, the senator is coming to town and he would like you to join him for dinner. And here I would be sitting with 10 people around a table, sitting next to the future president of the United States. Can you believe that? And we were discussing issues about public education, quality health care, and economic development, job creation in America and in Ohio. And it was a great thing for me because I was planting the seed that one day this guy might be president and he'd know who I was. You know, I could pick up the phone and say, yeah, White House. Yeah, this is Kevin Boyce. Oh yeah, he knows me, he knows me. Just tell him Kevin Boyce is calling. And the president would get on the phone and say, hey buddy, what can I do for you? And I'd say, Ohio needs $10 billion. And he'd say, it's on the way. And so I was really excited about this and felt like I was developing this great relationship with what would be the future president of the United States. And I'll never forget when I became treasurer, he was getting inaugurated as 44th president. And so he was coming to Columbus to deliver the first batch of stimulus dollars to the city of Columbus. And I was excited because I had been a part of a team for the city working to get those dollars to save a police class that we had on the chopping blocks. I'm sure Mayor McClellan understands the challenges that urban cities like Columbus and Dayton and Cleveland and Cincinnati are going through. And so I was excited because I knew the president. Well, I pulled my staff together. Now when you're treasurer, you get this fairly good-sized staff and there's all these talented and trained people. And so I called them together and I said, okay, president's coming to town, call the White House and let them know that Kevin Boyce would like to meet with them. Do you think we even got a call back? That's just how big time I was. We didn't even get a call back. And I never forget, I went home that night very disappointed, and I remember getting a ring on my cell phone, Commissioner. And it was the White House. And it was a lady by the name of Carol from the White House. And she said, Mr. Boyce, I wanted to let you know that the president's going to be in town delivering the first batch of stimulus dollars to the city of Columbus, the first in the entire country to Columbus, because he wants to save your police class and help your city. And he has invited you personally to join him. And get this, he's invited you to sit in the clutch. Now you're thinking what I was thinking. What's the clutch? But I said yes because you know what? It could have been a fiery pit and I would have said yes to the president. And so the next day I show up, I've got my staff in tow. We show up and sure enough, when we walk into the Latin Shrine Temple, the White House staff is there to greet me. They say, Mr. Boyce, we're gonna take you this way. We're gonna take your staff this way. We walk down this long corridor. The room was almost about the size, maybe a little bit larger, maybe a half a room size larger. And we walked down this long corridor, and as we come out from behind the curtain, I realized that they're seating me in the clutch, and the seat is in the furthest part of the room away from the stage where the president's gonna be. This is supposed to be the clutch, right? And so I take further notice, and I notice that they're seating my staff in like the second row from the stage. And so I'm saying, what's up with this? And so being a politician, Senator Strayhorn, you know how it is. You know, you can't be shy about standing up for what you believe in. You can't be shy about going after what you want or advocacy on behalf of constituents, whatever the case. And so I start working my way up to the front of the room and I'm gonna take one of those seats. I'll catch somebody sleeping and I'll slip right into their seat. And as I'm walking, I get a tap on the shoulder. And it's the lady from the White House. And she says, Mr. Boyce, I'm gonna have to ask you to go back to your seat. You're in the clutch. And so finally I was really agitated, I was really annoyed, and I turned to her and I said, okay, I'm sorry, I don't know, what's the clutch? What is this clutch you're talking about? And she said, well, the clutch is, when the president comes to town, he invites a few key select people that he would like to personally greet, shake their hand, and say hello. He asked for you specifically to join him behind stage after his speech. And I said, I'm gonna go on back over to my seat. You won't have no more problems out of me tonight. But you know what? It's this clutch that I want to talk to you about for just a brief moment tonight, and then I'll take my seat because I know the evening's been long. And I promise I'll skip over some of my notes here. But it's the clutch that I want to talk to you about tonight. In Ohio, and indeed in America, we're all searching for our moment in the clutch. That split moment of opportunity or access to opportunity for success. In Ohio, we're working to rebuild the clutch so that you and your families can have access to the opportunities that help make this country, build our families, and that will lead us in a 21st century global economy. But I tell you, as I think about creating the clutch, I think about my own upbringing. And I think about some of the earliest memories that I have in life. And the earliest one I can think of is that of when I was about 7 years old. We grew up in the housing projects in the city of Columbus on the east side, a place called Chesterville. It's a rough neighborhood, AKA Uzi Alley. But I remember one morning getting a knock on the door. It was my aunt who lived a few doors down. Our mother answered the door and she quickly ushered her into the kitchen. Moments later, I heard my mother fall to the ground crying. She came back into the living room and set my sister and I on her lap and shared with us my father had just been murdered. Now here's a guy who served two tours in Vietnam, only to come back to his own community, his own neighborhood, and have his life taken by a fellow citizen. And while that was a tough experience and a tough memory for me, what I know about life best is that sometimes it's the tough experiences that make us who we are and strong enough to experience other challenges in life. But I also learned that there are people who step up to fill the void in life. People like my grandmother you heard in my bio that helped to raise me. And my grandmother taught me some of the best lessons that I ever learned in life, and one of them that I use as a member of Columbus City Council for 10 years, and I certainly use as a state treasurer today and in my own household with my own two sons. When I was about 16 years old, I remember going to my grandmother and asking her to help me purchase a new pair of sneakers. She enthusiastically said, okay, we jumped in her car right at that moment, only to pull up to the local grocery store where she took me in to fill out a job application as a bagger. The message then, and it's the same today. Perhaps I'll provide the opportunity for you, but it'll be up to you to take advantage of it. Up to you to be prepared for your moment in the clutch. Ohio has been devastated over the last decade. Since 2000, we've seen nearly 300,000 manufacturing jobs evaporate from our economy. You see in the media and in the news every day how automakers like GM, Chrysler, and Ford are on the verge of bankruptcy, bailout, or buyouts. The implication to Ohio could be devastating. Nearly 500,000 people could be impacted. Unemployment rates are at decades high, while our pension while our pension funds continue to lose asset value. This year in 2009, if for every dollar that was put in our pension funds, 70 cents remains. But it's even worse for African Americans. African Americans make up 12% of the state of Ohio's population, yet make up nearly half of our correctional institutions. While the unemployment rate for Ohio is hovering just under 11%, the unemployment rate for African Americans is just over 15%. Now, more than ever, you can look at any urban public school system in the state of Ohio and see our toughest challenges through the eyes of our young people. But as I talk about the clutch and the creation of the clutch, it's more than just a destination to sit for your moment and your access to opportunities. It's also a metaphor for a promise to the next generation. It's a promise for us, you and I, the NAACP and elected officials throughout the state of Ohio, to build 21st century global-based schools. It's a promise to build quality and affordable health care and provide access for all citizens. It's a promise to implement strong economic development policies and create jobs that pay well and jobs that stay well right here in the state of Ohio, so that everyday working families can have their opportunity and their moment in the clutch and access to success. It's a promise to build communities of yesterday, communities like you and I remember, where you could play on the street until the street lights came on. You remember that? And everybody was a part of raising you as a young person. It's a promise that the NAACP has led for over 100 years for freedom, equality, and justice. But because we've seen the first African-American president is not a sign that things have changed forever. Now more than ever, what we do as members of the NAACP and members and representatives of our communities throughout the state of Ohio matters more than it ever has. Because if we're going to build a foundation for our young people to be able to grow and legacy that they can follow, then right now it'll start with you and I fighting to continue building freedom, equality, and justice for their lives and providing them with their moment and their opportunity to sit in the clutch. The theme today is transforming our community through shared vision, equality for all Americans, bold dreams, big victories. But I can't sit down until I ask you the question, what's your role in making tomorrow better than today? It starts right here in Dayton and expands all the way to Columbus, Cleveland, Cincinnati, Toledo, and all of those cities and townships in between. And if you and I can partner together, we can turn this state around. This is not about black or white, Democrat or Republican. It's about Ohio and it's about America. And it requires all of us to do our part and join together to make it happen and make it right. Let me close with a story about the Lord and the holy man. One day, the Lord and the holy man were having a conversation. The holy man asked the Lord, he said, Lord, what's the difference between heaven and hell? The Lord showed him two doors. They opened the first door and they walked through, and in the middle of the room is a round wooden table. In the middle of the table is a large pot of stew. The holy man can tell that the stew has been made with the freshest meats and the best vegetables. The aroma is good and his mouth is watering. But he observes even further around the table and he notices that there are thin and sickly people around the table. They're struggling to breathe and coughing, and their face is filled with concern. But he looks even closer and he notices that attached to their arms are long wooden spoons. And he notices that they can actually dip the spoon into the stew, but because the spoon is so long, they can't put the stew into their mouth. The Lord says to the holy man, you've just seen hell. Then he takes him over to the second door. Same observation, he notices a round table in the middle of the room, and in the middle of the table is a large wooden bowl of stew. He notices that it's once again made with the freshest vegetables and the best meats. The aroma is good and his mouth is watering. He observes around the table, this time, very happy people. They're jovial, plump, and enjoying life. He observes even further that they've got the same long wooden spoon strapped to their arms. The holy man turns to the Lord and says, but Lord, I don't get it. I don't understand. That was hell and this is heaven. I'm not sure I understand. And the Lord responds that there's only but one rule here, one lesson that you need to know and understand. See, here in heaven, those folks learn to feed each other.
And that's the difference between heaven and hell. I'm going to take my seat, but before I do, let me just say thank you to the Dayton NAACP and all of the NAACP chapters throughout the state of Ohio. God bless Dayton, and God bless the Ohio Treasury. Thank you very much.
And we can't let him get out of here without showing some recognition and showing some appreciation for him coming this evening, even through the tough times of him struggling through in terms of his laryngitis. All right. Now, this is the Honorable Kevin L. Boyce, Treasurer for the State of Ohio. In appreciation for being the keynote speaker at the Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet, October 23rd, 2009, signed by Omar J. Williams, Derek L. Ford, President, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the NAACP. Thank you very much, Treasurer Boyce.
Thank you.
And before Sharon calls for the retirement of the colors, step on up here. this is going to be presented to Sharon D. Howard in recognition for being the mistress of ceremonies at the Dayton Unit NAACP 58th Annual Freedom Fund Banquet, October 23rd, 2009, signed Omar J. Williams, Derek L. Ford, President, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the NAACP. Sharon, thank you very much, and thanks for keeping us on task. Thank you.
How many plaques did you order for tonight? I just want to know. Let me ask Central States Army ROTC to please come forward, retire the colors. We're going to have the benediction after that. I know people are trying to leave, but we're before 9, so let's just kind of hold it just a minute. We're before 9 o'clock. Isn't that great? Please stand, everyone.
Order, halt!
Please remember the private reception. Oh, no, I'm sorry, public reception right outside the doors when you leave. For the benediction, please welcome Elder Ronald McNabb, Chaplain, Ohio Conference, NAACP. When he's done, please drive safely.
God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far on our way, thou who has by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever on the path, we pray, lest our feet stray from the place, our God, where we met thee, lest our heart drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Thou who is by thy might, lead us into the light. Keep us forever in the path, we pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you for this wonderful celebration, this wonderful Freedom Fund banquet, and all the recipients of awards. Thank you for this great convention that has been going on. Certainly as we go from here, we pray that your presence will go with us. Bless the fellowship in the reception, and bless us all day tomorrow. May we have strength, may we continue to be encouraged by the various workshops, and then that great AXO gala tomorrow night. Now go with us, those we ask thee for traveling mercies of those that have to hit the highway tonight, and bring us back together at the appointed time. In Jesus' precious name, the Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen, amen, amen. Be blessed. Thank you.